Welcome to the first podcast of the Helen McArdle Nursing Care Research Institute series of podcasts that we'll be running throughout the year. I'm Dr. Yitka Graham, head of the Helen McArdle Nursing Care Research Institute. Our podcast today focuses on entrepreneurship and innovation in nursing, which are activities which are synergistic with and can be underpinned by applied research to make a difference to nursing practice and patient care. I'm delighted to introduce our guest today, Lisa Rickers, who's a specialist bariatric nurse and founder of Nurse Innovation UK. She has been working tirelessly and passionately to drive entrepreneurship and innovation in nursing on a national level with a view to extending this into midwifery. Lisa began working in the field of bariatric and metabolic surgery in 2006 when this field was just emerging. Working closely with bariatric patient support groups, Lisa was able to gain a valuable insight and understanding into the lived experience of obesity and reflect upon this in both her nursing practice and role within the bariatric multidisciplinary surgical team. This enabled her to recognize there were shortfalls in how care was traditionally being delivered. Despite trying to change the system from the inside, Lisa failed to implement changes into a health system which was not ready for change, one that saw obesity as a failure of the individual. Lisa is now exploring how to deliver this via a digital platform and is at the start of her journey in creating a social enterprise along with people who've had a lived experience of obesity and bariatric surgery. Weight bias and stigma was not the only barrier that Lisa experienced during this time, and it is one experienced by many nurses who want to reimagine how services are delivered. Her experiences have led Lisa to found Nurse Innovation UK, which is a movement to host and support grassroots nurse innovation. Lisa, welcome to the University of Sunderland.
Thank you, Itka. That was an amazing introduction. Thank you. Makes me sound like I've done so much.
You have. But tell Lisa, what really fascinates me, I appreciate we've talked about you, but how did you come to set up Nurse Innovation UK? How did you go about it? How did you start?
I kind of started this, it's very recent, so probably June 2020 is when I first started doing something physically in terms of doing something for Nurse Innovation UK. And as you'd mentioned in the introduction, I'd spent sort of around 5 years trying to deliver a new innovative platform whilst working in the NHS. And after that didn't work, I left the NHS for a while, so I had some time and space to sort of work on that project. During that time, I attended lots of different startup events within Oxford. Oxfordshire has a great startup hub in that area. But what I did notice is that I was often the only nurse there. And at times reception wasn't that supportive. I've been told that my idea may have been more credible if I had a doctor as part of the co-founding team. And kind of that really infuriated me because I'm sure that doctors aren't given the same advice. But despite this, I persevered and I've made some really great contacts along the way who've been really supportive. But it's not been an easy journey and I found the process at times to be very intimidating. You know, and I got to think that there must be an easier way to get sort of information and support. And I was constantly just asking the question, why am I the only nurse here? And I discussed this with a lot of different organisations, including nursing organisations, and everyone agreed that it was a problem. But I didn't see a lot that was being done to change it. So after discussing it and seeing no change, I thought, well, you know, if no one else is prepared to do this, then maybe I should. And I really wanted to encourage nurses to be involved in innovation, as I knew that kind of nurses have this unique vantage point within service delivery and patient experience, and that this was of particular value and this perspective was largely being ignored in most of the health tech startups. And I really was very passionate about that this was an important perspective that sort of needed to be heard. So I guess one day I just set up a Facebook group and started inviting colleagues along to that. And then I started a LinkedIn group and called it Nurse Innovation UK. And now I've got a vision of how I want to create and promote a grassroots movements for nurse innovation. I guess I've still got a long way to go and I'm just kind of taking it a step at a time. And I'm looking to really co-create this space with nurses for nurses. And so we're really looking for nurses to get involved as well and be part of this journey.
Yeah, no, that's great. And I love that co-creation, that thing that, you know, you're promoting inclusion. And I think the fact this is focused on nurses, because we know, sort of similar to research, sometimes those paths aren't straightforward, they're not carved mm-hmm. out, and it takes people such as yourselves, I mean, all that sort of frustration, which is negative, mm-hmm. you flipped it into a positive and put it in a space where, rather than just accept what was going on, accept the status quo, you went, no, I'm going to change it. You know, if it's not there, I'll put it there. So, you know, a woman after my own heart, thank you. And that's absolutely fantastic. Can I just ask, because we will have some nursing students here, and some of the terms just might be a bit unfamiliar to them, but just how would you define innovation and entrepreneurship in sort of a nursing context? How are these things applicable specifically to nurses?
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's a number of different definitions for innovation and entrepreneurship. And I guess probably a distinction that we should make is the difference between innovation, entrepreneurship, and also an improvement project, which I think sometimes are used interchangeably. And, you know, when we talk about innovation, we're often referring to a new way or a novel approach to solve a problem or to bridge a gap in care. It's generally sort of out of the box thinking, and it's often referred to as entrepreneurship. And although some will say that they're an intrapreneur as well, which then makes it even more confusing. So I guess an entrepreneur is someone who's got their own idea of their own business, their own money. And an intrapreneur is often an employee within an organization. So for me, you know, I tried the route of an intrapreneur whilst working within the NHS organisation. And when that didn't work, I've kind of moved towards the step towards entrepreneurship and setting up outside of the organisation. But I guess a lot of nurses are probably more comfortable with an improvement project. And this is often a lot more supported within NHS culture as well, because there's this incessant drive for efficiency and to work with less resources. But I guess for many people, for many of the problems that we're now facing in nursing, we need more than an improvement to services and pathways, and we need to reimagine how those services are run, how care can be delivered. And with the changes in adoption of digital health, there are so many exciting possibilities. But I guess we just need to be mindful that we don't lose that close relationship, our unique vantage point that we have with patients and our communities. So it's trying new ways in which we can combine that. So it's set up at this time for lots of innovation.
Mm-hmm. No, that's great. Can you think, I think probably the pandemic has sort of driven things, and like you say, rethinking. And I love the word that you said about reimagining. Mm-hmm. And also, I've never heard the term intrapreneur until we've had that conversation. No, but thank you for defining that, because I think, you know, as nurses who are employees of the NHS, that, you know, when you said about, you know, entrepreneurs having their own money, their own, you know, a nurse working in the NHS is likely not going to have access to it. So I think it's really important to define mm-hmm. that intrapreneur. So thank you for that. So in terms of where nurses are positioned, and things, why do you think, why is entrepreneurship and why is innovation so important to the nursing profession?
Well, I guess, as I mentioned, like for nurses, we've got this vantage point that we have within sort of service delivery, that, you know, knowledge and experience of the patient experience, and that's also navigating logistical hurdles as well. And I think this front row seat gives nurses a great perspective on what works and what doesn't work. Mm-hmm. And we can see and often make changes to bridge those gaps in care. And in America, they call this the workaround. I don't know if you've heard of that term before. Mm-hmm. So nurses, we're already doing this. We're already innovating without even knowing that we're actually, that's what we're doing. But I think where we tend to go wrong a little bit is that a lot of the challenges that we work on are often quite local challenges, mm-hmm. and it largely goes unnoticed by organisations, because we see a problem, we solve it, we put something into place, and we don't really talk to anybody about it. Mm-hmm. You know, but if we could consider training our nurses in this skill set to think more globally and sustainably about the challenges and solutions, you know, if we got somewhere we could go where we could collaborate with other nurses to share our successes and failures, mm-hmm. you know, I think that that's going to be a huge sort of game changer as well. And I guess, you know, in the NHS culture as well, and I should mention a little bit more about sort of that we can learn just as much from our failures as we can from our successes, mm-hmm. but we want to be able to learn to fail fast so that we can try a different approach. And the NHS culture doesn't really embrace that type of approach. And we're very risk averse in the NHS as well. Mm-hmm. But I guess when we do that, we limit learning, we limit opportunities for growth and insight. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's a real shame. Mm-hmm. And I think at the moment, you know, as nurses, we work in silos, but we'll have more influence if we, you know, and sort of greater impact on outcomes if we worked collectively. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I guess I do think that, you know, we're skilled at being the hub between the patient and the healthcare system. And I think it's the hugely valuable insight that we have. And it's a travesty that it's not being harnessed with the increase in health innovation. Mm-hmm. And we make up the largest sector of the healthcare sector. And this is a voice and perspective that's being ignored. And I often ask the question, you know, what's the cost of that? Mm-hmm. And when we you know, we often talk about improving diversity and innovation. And often if we think about that in a perspective of we're looking to gain a different perspective, yet we're ignoring the perspectives of, you know, one of the largest members of the healthcare sector. So, you know, I guess for me, you know, the biggest question is, you know, it seems illogically that we're not doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you've just justified the rationale for setting up Nurse Innovation UK. And I think it's great the way you set the context for that and sort of shown the frustration sort of within the systems. But, you know, as you speak, you frame everything as an opportunity. And I think even thing like learning from failure, like what a great concept. You know, I was told somebody, about 6 months ago, but, you know, when they said when you fall, they said always fall forward. Yeah, and I just thought, you know, and you're echoing sort of the same sentiment. It is about, you know, triumphing, you know, in adversity and in negative situations, like just taking the learning from it and taking it forward, not just situating it and walking away from it, but where's the lesson? You know, how can we learn from this? And I think that's just really coming through loud and clear.
If we don't fail, you know, we miss an important aspect of learning, because, you know, knowing what doesn't work is equally as important as, you know, being able to then understand, well, what does work and why does that work?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. No, that's great. Thank you. Lisa, the Helen McArdle Nursing Care Research Institute is an integral part of the Sunderland School of Nursing. And I know that many of our new nursing students will be tuning into this podcast. What advice would you offer our nursing students around learning about entrepreneurship and innovation? So, you know, they're in their training, they're out on placement, you know, we encourage, you know, reflective mm-hmm. practice within the nursing profession. So when someone's just starting out and perhaps hasn't had a lot of that experiential learning that would come from being a few years in practice, how can they start to develop that mindset now? What advice would you give to nursing students?
I guess, you know, we really haven't, even nurses that's been in practice a long time, we're not skilled in innovation. So it's kind of like a level playing field at the moment for all of us, because we're all learning together. And you know, there's not a lot of content directed towards nurses for innovation, but there is a lot more content that's available in America around design thinking and nurse innovation. And I can share some resources as well so your students can take a look. But, you know, I do think that this is what should be included in nurse training programs, so that, you know, because I think when you're new, whether that's new to training to be a nurse or it's a new job or a new role, you know, you've got a great advantage in that you're seeing things with fresh eyes. And we all fall into those habits of just doing things a certain way. So, you know, when you're new, you've got this fresh perspective, and it's a perspective of new possibilities and solutions. So, you know, I think that, you know, that's kind of, you know, puts us all equally on the same playing field, really, to just try and find solutions together and you know, work collectively. Mm-hmm. But I guess in terms of, you know, sort of thinking sort of more sort of, kind of, you know, the way that we see nursing and the approach of nursing, and And I guess, you know, we need to move away from, you know, nurses being seen as solely being the doers. And, you know, over the years, as nurses have advanced, we've taken on new practices, we've extended our practice, we're doing traditionally what doctors would have done. And, you know, and the NHS has embraced that because we're cheaper. We've shown that the outcomes...
expensive, never cheap.
You know, we've shown that the outcomes, you know, remain the same or have improved, you know, despite nurses delivering that. So, but we don't tend to get the same recognition. And I think, you know, we've been promised that we can have it all. And I think now we've discovered that that means doing it all. And I think as a result, you know, we've suffered from, you know, physical and mental health of nurses have deteriorated over the years. And we've seen this so very, very clearly within the COVID-19 situation. Mm-hmm. So I think it's time to do things differently and ensure that nursing is sustainable and that we don't see nurses leaving the profession or being off sick with burnout. You know, and we're not sort of investing, you know, all of this into training nurses for them to leave in a few years because, you know, it's where they're not getting the support that they need. So, yeah, I think we just need to move away from nurses being the doers and to be seen more as knowledge workers. And I think when we look at innovation, you know, we see that, you know, knowledge workers are included as important stakeholders. But I think if we're nursing's not seen in this way, then that's one of the reasons perhaps we've been overlooked for our contribution. Mm-hmm. So I think, yeah, if we can bring that into the nurse training and, you know, as people training for nursing at the moment, you know, you're going to be part of the solution. And that's an exciting possibility.
Absolutely. Do you know, I love this positiveness and this enthusiasm. It's absolutely infectious. Can you think, Lisa, just to sort of just build on what you've just said, could you give some examples of innovation that have been nurse-led?
Yeah, there's been some amazing examples of nurse innovation, and I've shared lots of stories on the group in LinkedIn and Facebook as well. But I can share with you just maybe three examples. Mm-hmm. So trying to look at things from different perspectives as well, just to give people more of an idea of you know what they could be doing as well. And a recent innovation during the COVID-19 pandemic involved one of my nurse colleagues at Imperial Health, Noni Nathy. She saw that the PPE requirements was creating a problem for the BAM colleagues. And she noted that for, you know, colleagues that with natural afro hair meant washing their hair at the end of every shift wasn't possible. So once she'd identified this problem, she sort of set about trying to find potential solutions. And actually, she's now brought about a change in uniform policy with appropriate head coverings now available throughout the trust. So, you know, just on the thing of seeing a problem and thinking about those solutions, it's now informed, you know, a whole uniform policy and not only within the Imperial Trust, but also wider field as other trusts are now picking up on that as well. So I guess another one that I really like is there was a team of prison nurses who've redesigned their service in a prison located in Wales in Bridgend. And they'd identified, you know, this kind of unmet need of people in prison with learning disabilities and autisms, and actually that their needs were not being met in this custodial sentence. And so they'd identified that, you know, we needed some kind of specialist input really to help reduce these health inequalities within this vulnerable group in order to help them navigate the complex system set up in prison and also to reduce the risk of them being exploited by their peers as well. And I guess I didn't know this, but you know, up to a third of people assessed in prison are reported to have a learning disability. So, you know, there's a large number of people there that needs aren't being met. But since they've introduced a new service, they've reported, you know, incidents have fallen by, you know, a great amount, over a third of incidents have fallen. And the incidence in self-harm has been reduced by, you know, just over 75%, which I just think is just an amazing statistic. And, you know, they're not just helping the vulnerable group whilst they're in custody, but they're making links and changes to support them after their custodial sentence in order to help them keep them, you know, keep them out of prison as well. So I guess that just really shows just, you know, how working across systems can really, you know, redesign how services are delivered, and just how crucial nurses have been in that process of change as well.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Yeah, no, hugely amazing work that's been going on. And then another amazing project as well that has been developed, and this has sort of been being developed during the COVID-19 phase as well. And this was developed by an advanced nurse practitioner called Rosie Ungerkorn. And she saw that obviously there was lots of homeless people sleeping rough on the streets of London, and they were being excluded from mainstream services, you know, particularly during COVID. And they'd initially, and this is again is an example of how we can learn from failure, but they'd initially tried their program in providing sort of clinics in day centres, but they discovered that this was excluding many of the people that were sleeping rough. And so they changed their tactic, and now they seek out the people on the street or in charity run locations. And at times they've been the only service providing outreach care, because the day centres and night shelters have closed, and specialist homeless GP practices have all gone on to remote working. So this left, you know, the people on the streets with little information. And just the simple things like being unable to wash their hands as the public toilets were closed. So, you know, they found new ways in which to reach these people, you know, through partnerships formed with churches and sort of local drug support service as well. And I guess, you know, again, it's kind of, you know, when we look at the impact that this has had on those sort of homeless people, you know, it's offered them a human connection. It's helped ease their isolation and help the people on the streets feel cared for. Half the people in Rose's team was not registered with a GP, and about 80% were not accessing clinics. So this, you know, approach has enabled us to reach the people who've had no access to healthcare. Mm-hmm. So again, just another amazing example of what work's being, you know, done within nursing.
Absolutely. And I think what resonated with me when you were saying about not having access to hand washing, and I think those key messages coming from the government, you know, washing your hands is a core facet of that message. And then you've got a vulnerable population and, you know, not having access to sort of a basic intervention, which, you know, the government has highlighted as, you know, crucial in the fight against COVID-19. So that's so inspirational. That's wonderful. Thank you for those examples. Lisa, how does a nurse start their innovation journey? What tips have you got for them? Where do we begin? Because I can see how it could grow, but where's that starting point?
I think that's a really good question. And I guess the first thing that, and if we look at the examples that I've just mentioned, the first thing is that, you know, people see a problem or something that isn't working well, you know, and this often comes up in your working day or when you're talking to colleagues, patients, carers, you know, about sort of some of the issues or problems that you're facing or, you know, some of the holdups. And then I guess the next question to ask is, you know, does your problem require an improvement to a service? In which case that would be an improvement project, you know, or does it require you to reimagine how that service is delivered? And that's kind of where we come into sort of looking at an innovation project. And I guess talking to your colleagues about your observations and then, you know, have a look around, see if anybody else is working on that solution to the problem. And I'd always encourage people to try and collaborate with others, as it gives you something to sort of bounce your ideas again and again, just gain different perspectives. And if you find that no one is working on the project, then think, who do I need on my team to help solve this problem? Who are the important stakeholders? And then just start talking to them. There are some really great design tools that you can use to help you ask the important questions. So, you know, there's lots of information out there. And again, often it's you having to seek it out. So that's one of the reasons in terms of Nurse Innovation UK is that having all that information to hand would be just so useful and reduce, you know, people's time and efforts. So, but you know, I think this can open up just new ways of working, sort of, and extending that within charities, social enterprises, and community groups as well, just so that we get, you know, a broader perspective in terms of, you know, how we address that problem, and again, thinking about how we can make that sustainable over time.
So I think just about starting off, and you mentioned, can, you know, as a part, and you mentioned the shared learning and resources and things, how can somebody, I think of sort of a really good thing at the start of somebody's journey is actually to link in with people like yourselves and share that idea, like look at those resources, reflect on what's available. How does somebody join Nurse UK, and can students join Nurse UK? Nurse Innovation UK, sorry.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So at the moment, we're just still emerging, and obviously we've got groups on Facebook and also LinkedIn. So yeah, you're more than welcome to come and join our group. We'd love that. You know, and if people want to be more involved and they want to sort of think about sort of, you know, strategically how they can then do that, then obviously just reach out to me as well. You know, I'm really happy to sort of work with people on that. And I'm hoping that, you know, we can get some sort of funding to create a space. I've had lots of offers of people wanting to help us because they soon see, you know, how nursing can be so influential in innovation. And so we've got lots of people that would like to come on board and deliver some free sessions as well. So we just really, the next step is to create that sort of space where we can do that. And again, just, you know, being able to collaborate with one another and see if anybody else is working on those sort of ideas as well, I think would be really crucial.
Yeah. So are you quite happy for the Institute to share your, you know, the details of the Facebook groups and the LinkedIn groups and that? No, that's great.
Thank you. Absolutely.
Thank you for that. I'm going to ask you a question which is not negative. It's a constructive question, but what are the barriers to nurse innovation, Lisa?
Yes, there are a number of barriers, and again, these are all just, it's great to identify the barriers because it then starts to mean we can look at ways in which we can sort of address them and innovate around them as well. So, and I guess one of the first things is lack of training. You know, nurses aren't offered any training on how to take their ideas and observations forwards and how to create an innovation project. Again, I think that's something that we can quite easily change in a collective way. And there's also kind of, you know, there's a bit of an acceptance within the NHS of, you know, status quo. And we all know that there are problems and there are shortfalls. And we can sometimes start to accept these as the norm. Mm-hmm. And I guess we've all got roles in the NHS. And at times it means that we don't want to take on extra responsibility for reviewing how things are done. And also sometimes we don't want to rock the boat. So, you know, again, it's kind of, you know, these are some of the cultural changes that we see within the NHS that really don't sort of cultivate an environment of innovation. And then, you know, we've got the organisational hierarchy in the NHS. It's very much a top-down approach. It's this command and control style of managing risk. And I guess that culture, it places the blame culture, doesn't it? And it doesn't really foster the right environment for innovation. You know, our managers and organisational hierarchy don't necessarily want to stop nurses doing all those tasks because it's going to create a huge logistical problem in terms of how care is delivered. If we're all off innovating, who's going to be doing the hands-on care? You know, and I've often heard the response from managers saying, you know, this isn't the time for innovation. I just need you to keep doing what you're doing. It works, just carry on. Or, you know, if you don't like how it's done, then go and work somewhere else, you know. Mm-hmm. And again, these are kind of just not ways in which we encourage people to innovate. Mm-hmm. And I guess, you know, the experience of nursing, for nursing staff, it's a toxic cocktail of unmanaged demand and little control. Mm-hmm. And it's changed very little over time. It's a really great survey conducted between Nesta and the Nursing Times in 2019. And, you know, they sought to do a survey to find the views of around 300 healthcare workers. And they consistently reported that frontline innovation was stifled by a culture that ignores new ideas. So, you know, at the minute for nurses to innovate, it's almost as though, you know, there's got to be something within that nurse that kind of makes them do it, regardless of all the barriers that are in place, you know, that just drives them forward because they're obviously feeling so passionate about what they're trying to do. And I guess just mentioning is that, sorry, we probably didn't want as many barriers, but I think we're working in silos within organisations and within the health and the social care, and that creates sort of just a lack of opportunity to collaborate and engage those stakeholders across the healthcare sector. And we've seen some good examples of this change in Wigan, and they've partnered so within the NHS, the council and other partners to create this Healthier Wigan partnership. And there's also a great book that I've been reading as well. And it's called Health is Made at Home, Hospitals Are for Repairs. And that's by Nigel Crisp. And this book is great for innovation because it really asks us to reimagine how we could create health rather than focusing on the management of disease. Mm-hmm. And it asks us to address the broader inequalities of health, such as housing, loneliness, poverty, obesity and addiction. And I think these are really key things that we've seen during COVID-19 where people are struggling. And it sort of really sort of celebrates and highlights initiatives that are taking action within our local communities and addressing the underlying causes and, like I say, creating health. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, those are all sort of good ways to sort of try and sort of find ways to overcome some of those barriers.
That's what, I'm just because I will be on Amazon immediately after this podcast getting that. I love nothing better than having a great library of reference, and that just sounds like it's an amazing philosophy, and what a great book. And just thank you again. You're just so generous with your resources. I think the one thing we have sort of a term that has since probably 2015 just sort of seems to permeate amongst the School of Nursing, you know, and within our faculty. I don't know if you've heard of the term disruptive innovation. And I would say, you know, I think we're fellow disruptive innovators here in this podcast, and that, you know, that and you're thinking about just not challenging it. And that you said when people saying, oh, it's not the time, it's not the place. Well, when is it going to be? And I think, you know, there are situations, you know, COVID-19 has, if you think about, you know, the move we've had from face-to-face, say, to video consultations, you know, mm-hmm. that is a huge cultural change, something we, but, you know, it's, there's opportunities for innovation within that. Do you know, and, you know, and what I'm picking up from you loud and clear, and again, you know, I'm right here with this, is the fact that barriers are opportunities for change. And yeah. I don't think, and, you know, it's sort of challenging the barriers. I appreciate some barriers are hard to sort of knock down, and we shouldn't knock down barriers for the sake of knocking them down, but sort of having that disruptive innovation mindset where if we can break them down in terms of opening up a conversation and creating something better, you know, and not only improving patient care but improving nursing practice, then it's well worth the disruption, if you like, because it's a positive outcome.
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, my philosophy really is, you know, it's all about inclusivity. And I think what I've seen so far in a lot of innovation that's happened is it's been exclusive. Mm-hmm. And there are barriers that stops people kind of having entry into those. And, you know, even when I talked about sort of startup culture within Oxford, you know, it's an exclusive kind of client, you know, sort of base of people, and I initially didn't really feel as though it was inclusive to me, but I still sort of banged on the doors and kind of went there along anyway.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, and I think that's it. And I think it's being that it's being courageous enough to do that, because I think, and it's that, and it's not that, and it is that fear of failure, as we say, that we have, but sort of just taking a deep breath, biting down hard and knocking on that door and just sort of realizing, you know, we deserve a seat at that table. Yeah. And if there is a perception that there isn't a seat there, then let's just go create a seat and let's just make sure we get that seat. But I think that can sometimes feel a bit intimidating and a bit frightening. But as Susan Jeffers says, we feel the fear and we do it anyway, don't we?
Yeah, and I think the important point as well is that when we get that seat, we make another seat for another person to come along who perhaps has been excluded, another voice that's not being listened to. And I think, you know, if we have that kind of, you know, mindset, we create a group of inclusivity.
Absolutely. No, I couldn't agree more. That's fantastic. So just flipping that, because I just love the way we've taken a negative concept and just put it into such an amazing positive space. So then what are the flip side of that question is, what are the enablers to nurse innovation?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. And I guess it's at the moment, it's the combination of seeking opportunities and your own mindset. There are some programs that are now targeting towards nurses, but then they're not, there's not a great deal within the UK at the moment, but there are a couple of initiatives that's an exciting developments within the Burdett Trust that I'd love to see grow. So I know that they've just introduced a major grant program to support nurse-led digital health innovation, and that's being launched in March. And they've also introduced a new role at Chelsea and Westminster for a nurse innovation fellow for 1 year to sort of help support frontline innovation and work with senior nurses to support this. And I just think, you know, that concept of that person being available in every trust within nursing to kind of really spear forward nurse innovation, I just think that would be just amazing if we could achieve that. But I guess, you know, I'll give you an example of something, you know, that I did, but in looking outside of the UK, really, and there are some exciting opportunities out there. And in May 2020, during the first lockdown, I took part in a virtual Nurse Health for Hack event in America, which was an amazing experience. And I registered for a weekend event, and I joined a team which was looking to deliver health to people in digital poverty. And I could say that probably digital poverty is a problem in the UK, but it's more of a problem in the in America and also developing countries. And we came up with a novel approach to deliver care via old mobile messaging systems. So it's a system that's often used to do bank transfers in other countries. And it's called USSDs, Unstructured Supplementary Service Data. So not something that trips off your tongue. But we'd created this idea, we created a pitch deck, and then, you know, we pitched that at the end of the weekend. And I guess there were around about 900 people taking part in this event. And actually, you know, we won the category that we'd entered for. So that was a great surprise at the end of the weekend. But, you know, I worked across sort of boundaries. So we were nurses, we were allied health professionals coming together from America, England and Africa to brainstorm a problem and find a solution. And, you know, that concept of coming together to tackle global health problems, you know, is an amazing enabler. And also we got support from mentors as well throughout the programme. So I guess, you know, the message is when the opportunities don't lie on our doorstep, we've got to look further afield to find them and just be a little bit more creative about them. And we do need to sort of take action to make those steps. You know, I could have found 101 different excuses not to take part in that event. But, you know, I kind of, you know, didn't know what to expect, just went along and just had an amazing experience. So I guess for me, the enablers is having that mindset where you'll go and seek out those opportunities. Wherever they lie, and it may not just be within nursing, it may be outside of, you know, nursing as well, that you can, you know, tap into and working with, you know, other people within different professions to form different perspectives. So I guess mindset is really crucial, but I think, you know, we got to the point where we had the environment and the culture to support nurse innovation, and then we had this amazing mindset of nurses who coming through training to have that mindset out there. I just think, gosh, you know, what could we be creating? I've talked about those three amazing examples of nurse innovation in the current climate. I mean, it just staggers me to think what's the possibility here.
Absolutely. And you did, and you mentioned allied health professionals. So as a research institute, we're nursing, midwifery and allied health professionals. And I think, you know, my observation from nursing is it's a profession that doesn't sit in a silo. It's very open and amenable to multidisciplinary and interprofessional working and building up that collective. So, and again, I'm personally picking up that, you know, you're saying opportunities, you know, where the nurses are great to drive it, but also there's opportunities to engage with other people and other professions. And when you're saying about getting that seat for nurses at that innovation table, and then exactly, and couldn't agree more about getting that additional seat, and, you know, and perhaps that could be occupied by a midwife, that could be occupied by an allied health professional.
Yeah.
And to just sort of have those open conversations, if you like, because I think the different ways of looking at a problem.
Yeah, absolutely. The you know, the broader the perspective, the more likely, you know, that you're going to have a better solution. Mm-hmm. And they're seeing this as well with any sort of any innovation project that's being worked on. You know, if one member in the team has had direct experience of the problem that they're trying to solve, mm-hmm. You know, they do often come up with better solutions. So, you know, I co-creating space with really important voices, you know, like we've seen, you know, with the Nurse Innovation Project so far, I think that's where, you know, it gives them sort of great strength. Because it's really understanding and walking in the shoes of people who are experiencing those problems.
So there is there also an opportunity when we're sort of adding more seats to this table, so very much involving patients and putting patients at that table as well. So, you know, and we've had this conversation where patients shouldn't be passive recipients of care. They should be part of that co-creation and influencing and shaping and develop that from really design to dissemination. Would you agree?
Absolutely. And that's really what I've learned through my, you know, working in the, with the bariatric community as well, is that by working with so closely with the support groups, you know, it made me realize that actually what I thought was a problem was probably not the problems that the people themselves were experiencing. So, you know, it really changed my sort of perspective. And I think that, you know, together we are going to create amazing solutions to, you know, problems that they have that lived experience in. You know, and I've got the experience to sort of navigate through those health systems that, you know, can be difficult and, you know, create problems along the way. So together we, you know, can create something that's just going to, you know, have the potential to sort of work in a much better way.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Just finally, Lisa, again, we've had many conversations, and both you and I strongly believe in the power of networks and of networking. And I personally feel that this is so important for student nurses to develop those networks at the beginning of the nursing careers, not wait till later on. What sort of advice could we give them now, sort of as they're going through, you know, their nursing training? How do we help them build these networks now?
Yeah, no, I think the power of network is something that UK nurses are not really doing enough of. Mm-hmm. And again, this comes back to our sort of siloed working patterns. And we've got some great platforms out there, you know, such as LinkedIn. And what surprises me about LinkedIn is obviously it's the professional network, but it's not really being used very extensively by nurses. But it enables us to have a much wider voice and to broaden our networks. So, and, you know, we can create links worldwide, you know, not only just helping us with our careers, but, you know, just enabling us to see, you know, what's out there, what the possibilities are happening, what other countries are doing in tackling health problems. Mm-hmm. And I guess for me, when I'm thinking about sort of solving problems and working on projects, you know, it really helps me to read extensively and network with people outside of the healthcare sector too. And, you know, the stronger and more diverse that network or reading really helps me foster a different new perspective. So it gives me a constant stream of new ideas that I can try out and experiment with. I don't ever feel that I'm lacking with kind of seeing what problems are out there and thinking about solutions in which, you know, we can sort of try to sort of, you know, help with that. So networking really does, you know, sort of help with that. And I guess, you know, one connection can lead to new possibilities and collaborations. But, you know, we need to make sure that the, you know, the strength of those connections are in the relationships that we develop. So it's not necessarily having the greatest number of people in your network. It's, you know, about having those important relationships that you can form collaborations with.
Exactly. And I think sort of within that networking, you mentioned it before, is about mentors and seeking out mentors, you know, to give that sort of positive support and guidance and benefit from their experiences. I think also you were mentioning LinkedIn and the Facebook page for Nurse Innovation UK. And I think also in the pandemic, you know, in terms of the safety perspective, because we can't have these face-to-face meetings that we're traditionally used to. But I think also, you know, social media allows us access to a wide range of people. Just say it's not just regional or national. Potentially there's global networks open to us. And I think possibly, the current situation has really highlighted an opportunity there. And I would say so perhaps engaging, so joining Nurse Innovation UK, you know, joining the Facebook page, the LinkedIn page, as you said, you know, and looking at who's there, what conversations are going on, what resources, you know, that are there that you can be signposted to. And that's sort of a grassroots, as you say, organic way of building up a really strong and sustainable network that will hold you well for the future.
Yeah, and I just think, you know, we're just going to have so much more strength with it, with numbers, you know, in terms of, you know, how we change this culture within sort of the NHS. And, you know, I guess personally, I'm you know, kind of tired of the top-down approach. You know, I've worked in the NHS for a long time, and you know, I just see, you know, that it doesn't work. And you know, we've got glimpses of it changing, and you know, there are sort of little pockets here and there where we see sort of, you know, managers thinking about sort of a more partnership style approach, and you know, more relationships type. But I guess, you know, even through COVID-19, you know, I've seen evidence of that, still of that top-down approach. And, you know, and I guess the nurses is pretty much kind of towards the bottom of that. and so it's not surprising that the voices aren't heard. But, you know, and this is where it's this important thing of, once you get that seat at that table, to make sure that you're welcoming another seat and bringing in another voice that's not been heard and not been listened to. And, you know, that's how we can make these changes happen.
Absolutely. And I think for sort of, you know, again, within a university, you've got a wide environment. You know, within Sunderland, we've got four faculties. And I know personally, the Institute works quite closely with the Faculty of Arts and Creative Industries on a lot of, you know, with that sort of link between arts and well-being. We've had some very successfully funded, you know, research grants that have made a difference to very specific underserved populations. And I think in terms of, as you say, that seat at the table, not just for, again, people in health, but perhaps, you know, the insight and the knowledge of an engineer or computing in terms of things for, you know, the digital innovation strategy. And just to sort of think perhaps how we as a university can engage that cross-faculty collaboration. Oh, you've given me so much inspiration here. This is great.
No, that sounds amazing. It really does. But, and I think the thing that we need to also tackle as well is just how, you know, we see sort of venture capital being allocated out to projects at the moment. And, you know, very much it's been focused on the next unicorn health tech business, and nurses don't innovate in that way. You know, our projects are more kind of about sort of tackling, you know, health inequalities, and, you know, looking sort of for more sustainable and ethical projects. And, you know, I think this is a niche that we can really see that impacts into, you know, on an individual level, and has, you know, sort of a real impact in terms of, you know, what we're setting out to achieve. And so I'd love to be able to see how we can, you know, work with kind of in a, you know, capital investors, just to see, you know, what we can do to sort of change that sort of script, really, and encourage sort of these sorts of initiatives to flourish. So, yeah, I mean, I just hope that we start to think about not so much return of investment, but also include the social impact as a measure of value as well, when we're looking at which initiatives to support in the future.
Absolutely. No, I think social impact, absolutely. I think that can't be underestimated. You know, the contribution that we have in that broad health and social care space, and the impact of what we do. As you say, it's not enough just to do it. It has to make an impact. And I think we have to measure that impact. And as you said, we have to share the learning and take that forward, and just that continuous journey. So it's not just sort of something with a start and finish. It's a lifelong concept almost, isn't it?
Absolutely, and I think that, we're in nursing, we're very good in terms of looking back at reflection, and I think reflection works really well with innovation in terms of, using that skill set. And like I say, I think, it's just about just reframing things probably in terms of, what we need to do to sort of to help encourage that.
Absolutely. Lisa, your enthusiasm, your commitment and your support to the nursing profession is just to be so highly commended. And just on behalf of the Helen McArdle Nursing Care Research Institute and the Sunderland School of Nursing, thank you not only for speaking for you today, but also for being a trailblazer, being a disruptive innovator, and just really getting out there and just being brave and pushing this message forward. You've created a whole auditorium, not a couple of seats around a table, I know this is just the beginning, and I can see, and I know this isn't the first conversation you're going to have with the Research Institute or the School of Nursing. And I think we're so proud to be able to support you and share this, but equally thank you for, giving your time and to speak to me. And I just hope you come back and keep us updated. And this is just the first of many conversations going forward.
Yeah, no, I'd love to. It's great. Thank you for giving me a platform to talk about this as well, and to sort of highlight, what we can start to achieve together. And I'm really super excited about sort of developing sort of new collaborations, working more closely, with students as well, and getting them involved in that process. Because one of my core beliefs is that we need to start this right from, the very beginning within our nurse training program. So thank you for giving me that opportunity.
Yeah, no, this is great. And I will share the LinkedIn and the Facebook and the contact deals for Nurse Innovation UK. But just once again, just thank you so much.
Thank you.